Welcome to the PowerShell users group for Arizona for, what is this, September? September. I would encourage you, if you don't know already, there is a PowerShell Saturday next month that I've set up and put together, and we have four or five speakers coming, and the folks from Tech Systems have agreed to sponsor us. So if you need information on that, please let me know. I'll be happy to give you the information on where to sign up, all that other kind of stuff. We have 80 open seats. So far, about 29 people have signed up, about. So if you're on Twitter and you can retweet, I'd appreciate it. We'll probably do some more tweets here pretty quick. So with that, what I'd like to do is, since they were so kind enough to buy us some dinner this evening, I'd like to turn over the floor to the folks from Tech Systems to say a few words. Okay, again, my name is Tom Schumacher. I've been in the computer industry for about 25 or 30 years, somewhere around there. I started my career as a Air Force guy for 10 years and got out because I wanted to do more with NetWare, if anybody's familiar with NetWare. And then after NetWare, I started moving into Microsoft, and then I found PowerShell, like, when I was at Dell and I was delegating to all these people overseas, and I finally got away from Dell so I could actually do some real work again, which was great for me. So this evening, what I'd like to do is show you what I pretty much do every day, all day, which is support .NET developers, and how we've chosen to implement Microsoft's a product called TFS, or Team Foundation Server, and specifically Team Foundation Server 2015, and how it works together with PowerShell. So many of the scripts that you write every day, day in and day out, you can actually plug into a pipeline that you establish and put in to your normal build and deployment engine that's part of TFS to get things stood up in particular environments. So, as I've said, I've spent about 5 or 6 years on this same set of scripts for IIS. I kind of started them when, back in the VB script days, actually building sites and whatnot with IIS when I was at Dell. Did a little bit with that, and then when I moved to the next set of companies. Okay, so as we go along, I'll show you what I've done to make the IIS scripting that I have put together. Well, some of it's old, some of it's new. In between, it's old and new because PowerShell's evolved, and I haven't evolved my scripts like I should, but they work, so until they break, I'll probably leave them mostly that way. So I'll show you how I use TFS and PowerShell together to build a site and deliver that site to not only a dev, but a QA and a production system. Now, keep in mind that because I have to show this overseas, and I don't know what my connectivity is going to be, all that kind of business. I've set up everything on a single VM, TFS, Visual Studio, everything's all on that same VM, but I will demonstrate to you that it actually makes separate sites with separate host headers and all the other stuff that goes with it, separate directories, all that kind of stuff. So what I'll do, the specifics on the sites are is it's going to create a site and it'll set the bindings. I do have some other scripts that, if you're familiar with the HTTPS and you needed to set bindings for HTTPS, I have that in the scripts. I just chose not to implement it for the purposes of this demo. But they're in the library that I have. It'll also set the bindings, which, as I indicated earlier, it includes HTTPS. Excuse me. And then to continue on the application pool, I set the CLR version, is it a 32-bit app or not? Manage pipeline, queue length, these different things that you see right here, including the identity for the particular site. Now, I chose to cheat a little bit. I created a local user, and I used that same user throughout the entire script so that I didn't have to set up multiples. But believe me, it works. I use it almost every day to do these kinds of things. So I'll give you the code if you want it, and you could tear it apart. Sir, go ahead.
So for the defaults that are set through IIS for this stuff, do you have to specify all this when you're implementing creating site?
No. Over time, I've kind of built some of those standard things that developers always ask me for, and I just kind of baked them in, and I took what I had at Pulte, which is who I work for, and I just carried it forward to this discussion, and some of that stuff came from the other company I was at last year, which was a e-commerce company. Volusion is the name of them. That was the company I was at before Pulte in Austin. Great question. Thank you. Okay, the other thing this does as well, as you well know, files have to be delivered when you're dealing with an IIS site. So this delivers the code, the release will actually deliver the files. And not only will it deliver the files, I follow it up with setting the NTFS permissions at the same time. So if the directory isn't there, it'll create the directory, and then it will add the user to the IIS users group. After it's added the user to the IIS users, then it will set the NTFS permissions. And I'll show you that in my basic setup, or my setup script here in just a moment. Okay. Again, as I indicated earlier, I'm gonna demonstrate for you this going to dev, QA, and production. I will also show you that the code actually operates in Visual Studio first, provided my machine cooperates with me. It's been a little cranky because I had to reboot it. So the process that I've set up here also allows for iterative change. So let's say you have some developers that are working on a website and they need to be able to work on some code and then have it automatically deploy out. That's exactly what this does. So in what I've set up here, it will automatically deploy to the dev environment first. And then once the dev environment's complete, it will automatically deploy to QA, and then it will automatically deploy to prod. Now, given that is not what I do at Pulte, but for the purposes of this demonstration, I set it up that way just to show you that it would work, and I was afraid that because my machine isn't as hefty as it should be, it was just a little bit more expedient that way. But I will show you in TFS that you can actually set who the approvers are and what the conditions are for your deployments on how you want them to happen, okay? In addition, there's some other scripting that's necessary when you're deploying code. Specifically, you need to stop and start a site, make sure that the site's actually alive, that kind of thing. And every time this runs through, if the site needs to be built, it's built during the deployment, okay? Kind of like DSC, but not really. Just to answer gentlemen in the back, I've been meaning to get to DSC, but I haven't had the time just yet. So, okay. So that's what I'm gonna try to show you to the best of my ability. Please feel free to stop and ask me any questions you want, whenever you want.
What if you have 5 or 6 different actors you need to configure? Can it do that?
So the question is what happens if I have multiple app pools that I need to set up? Can it do that? Sure. It depends on what your needs are. So the way I wrote the scripting is you pass it the name of the application pool, the name of the identity, and its password, and, oh gosh, a couple other things. And then you could create one, and then you could create another. You could pass an array to it and just change up the function a little bit. Or you could do it with individual lines. So the answer is yes. It really depends on your scenario. There might be a reason that you want to create app pool 1 and then it has to wait for app pool 2 has to wait on this one. So this one's first. There could be like a process that you need to follow to make things successful. So it really depends on your scenario.
But it's just all scripted.
Yes. There are a couple things that aren't scripted that I'm using straight out of the box from TFS, and that is copying of files. I'm using components that come with TFS, and I'm also using the built-in build capabilities that are already there, which I believe are They're either using MS Build or they're using PowerShell for it. Okay. Did I answer your question? Okay. As I indicated earlier, what I'm going to do is show you first that the application actually builds and what it looks like from a developer's perspective, okay? So what I did is I went out to Microsoft's website and I looked for something that I could just get and would work. And what I ended up happening to find was this product called Wingtip Toys. And it's very simply a .NET project that somebody put together at Microsoft that includes includes a working website, and also it creates a SQL database behind the scenes at the same time. It's all part of Code First technology. So each one of these environments that you will see actually has a database behind it that I'll show you in the web configs how that's actually specified and built at the same time. Now, how all that stuff works, to me, is sort of pure magic, right? Because it's done through some of the newer tools through MVC. And I don't fully understand all of that yet. I just know it works, so.
Would that be something analogous to AdventureWorks for SQL?
It might be. I haven't used AdventureWorks for SQL.
It's,
I don't know.
It's just their template learned here database sort of thing.
Yeah, so the question was, is that analogous to AdventureWorks, right? I don't know. It might be. Hopefully. Okay. So what you see here is one of my scripts that I have actually pulled up. So instead of that, what I'll do is go ahead and let's just run this solution. Does everybody here use Visual Studio? Some, a little bit. Don't be scared of it. There's lots of good stuff that happened with Azure with it. If you're familiar with Azure and JSON templates, it's awesome. You can deploy right from Visual Studio to Azure with it. It's really cool. Really cool. So cool that as a DevOps guy, I want to try to hold my developers back a little bit, right? Because it smells like danger. Danger, danger. Bear with me as my webpage spins up. So there you can see it's actually on my local machine there. 44300, which is what's configured in the solution. So this means it's going to run locally on this particular machine as soon as it loads. So behind the scenes, it's actually, it could be building the database. I don't remember if I dropped it or not. I don't think I did. I didn't drop the databases just simply because of performance reasons, because it takes a while to stand them up. Any questions while we're waiting on this to come up? No? Okay. Okay, so here you go. You can see we have this little product called Wingtip Toys. And I haven't really fooled with this product much other than to say that I know that it's up, it's operational, it works inside of IIS. And displays pages. So it's supposed to be one of those kind of things where you can add a product to a page and log in and all that kind of stuff, and you could see that it works, right? That's really what I was after, was something that worked. Okay? Any questions so far? Okay, so what I'm gonna do is go ahead and stop this. And then I'm gonna show you what we're gonna do with the application itself. So inside of Visual Studio, there's various plugins you can get that'll help you with changing things as they change in your environments. Specifically, they're called web transforms. Has anybody here dealt with a web transform? Nobody? Okay. So a web transform, what it does is, it's basically, think of it a rule that will do a search and a replace on whatever values you tell it to search and replace on. So what we tell our developers is, okay, add a configuration and a web transform, and we'll actually transform your config when we deploy your code, okay? So what that transform looks like, if you see right over here, I set up the different environments I'm gonna use. I mistakenly called it production instead of prod. So I had to make two web config transforms. But so in any case, what I'll do is I'll open up this config here that you see. And if you look up here at the top, you'll notice that we have a XDT transform and a replace and match on the key called environment. And then it will change it. In this case, since this is the dev transform, it'll change it to dev, which I'll show you where that's going to be in just a moment. In addition, the dev environment reports to a different database than the QA database, than the, you know, every kind of different environments that you have. They will actually use a different environment. So in this connection string transform, we have one transform. It's up here that actually does the creation of the database on when the app initially stands up. And then the second one, as you can see, these are SQL Express instances that are on this machine. Everything's contained here. It will actually transform. The main thing that we're looking for here for it to transform, if I can find my mouse, is this right here. You notice that's really the major thing that changes in this particular case. Let me see. Is that easier to see without it being in the line? Okay. Okay. Any questions so far? Okay. You're like, Tom, you're boring me with all this application stuff, right? We're going to get to the code, I promise. So again, just to demonstrate, here we have the prod transform. Notice that our environment value is blank. This is because the place that I'm going to put this piece of transform code is, do you recall when I launched the website, it said wingtips space local? Do you all recall that? That was based on this default web config. If we do a, if we look right here, notice it says local. Whenever we actually launch this, when we launch this in Visual Studio, that web page at the top, it'll say wingtips local. When we go to QA, it'll say wingtips QA, wingtips dev, whatever environment we're deploying to, except for production. Since it's a production host, we won't want everybody to know it's production. We know it's production, okay? So it was just a simple way that I chose that I knew if I change that transform, I could demonstrate that it's actually working and it's actually different code. Okay? It's the simplest thing to do. All right. So now, with that in mind, oh, beans. Okay. Man, that's being cantankerous. Okay. What you're looking at here is called TFS. This is actual TFS. This is the tool that we're using to actually turn the source code into a compiled DLL and then take that compiled source code and deliver it to the platform. Okay? So very briefly, I'm not going to spend much time on the build. I want to spend more time on the deployment because that's where most of the PowerShell code is. So if we edit this build, as soon as it comes up, you'll notice that we can do a NuGet package restore, which means if there's dependencies on NuGet packages that are out in NuGet, you can restore them, or if you have your own NuGet package repository, you could do that kind of thing. Same thing with Visual Studio build, and then any tests that a developer would actually write, unit tests, this will execute them. And then last but not least, we actually take the binaries after they're compiled and we deliver them to a staging location. And then from there, from the staging location, which is where our compiled code actually is, that's where we'll pick that up and then deliver it. The other thing that you see in here is along with the actual code that makes up the website that does all the business logic that we need, wingtip toys, we also have this checkout of scripts that support the website, all the code that you or I would write to actually deploy the code. So that actually comes out of, if we were to look in this code repository here, our PowerShell code is actually checked in here. So if you look here, you notice I have some directories, IIS, logging. If you look here very closely, you'll notice I have this is going to be the script that we use to transform the configs that I spoke about earlier. Here's our my NTFS module I wrote, hand-rolled, before I found out somebody had something better, but I'm still going to use it anyway. And then my logging module, which since I use it at Pulte, I decided to call it Pulte Logging. And then, of course, the IIS stuff I've put together.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Can you do templates? Because to me, if you're going to do a lot of these, the templates would be...
Yes, you can templatize this. So there's a bunch of extensibility for Visual Studio itself, both on-premises and up in Visual Studio Online, where you can create your own tools or tasks that can be templatized or however you choose to do it, yes. I've just barely scratched the surface on the things that you can do with the tool, both personally and what the tool and what I've demoed already. So there's a lot more that you could do. Because you can do things, like if you have developers that are using Node.js, there's processes in here that'll actually build Node.js and minify it and all that other kind of stuff. So that's all baked into the product. And it's something that you could use with that. And in addition, you can actually deploy, and we are using TFS. We're on the cusp of doing this, where we actually do a SSH session with a PowerShell script, and the TFS engine is actually our orchestrator, for lack of a better term, that actually orchestrates the execution of the script and who approved it or didn't approve it, that kind of thing that all goes with it. Did I answer your question? Okay. All right, so the meat of what this script actually does is this setup wingtip PowerShell script that I wrote. And what this is if you're familiar with parameters with PowerShell scripts, when you launch a PowerShell script and you type in minus param this, minus param that, that's what these are up here. So the first thing that I'm going to pass is where I'm going to copy this script. The way I wrote this script is since I just barely started writing modules myself about last year or the year before, I didn't follow the conventions that they tell you to write to. So I had to write this custom script to actually import my custom modules because I wanted them in a particular directory and I wanted to name them differently than a directory. So I kind of broke the rules. So I had to write this script I called import custom modules or something like that. And it takes some of this information that you'll see here in just a minute. So here you can see we have the, would it help if I zoomed in a little bit? Can everybody see? Okay. All right, so the very first one is the destination module location. This script is gonna take scripts that are on, like let's say we have a central build server. It'll take the scripts that are checked out and copy them to the destination where we're actually gonna run them, okay? Which is the source is where we're getting them from, and the destination is where they're going to. Okay? and then the source location, UNC. So I wrote myself some notes here on purpose. So I only use the source module location when I'm doing debugging for myself. The other one, this UNC location, I use for when I'm actually using it in a real-world scenario as doing continuous integration or continuous deployment. And I would put a UNC path for it. So it's not a required, the second switch is not a required switch. All right, then the app identity user and app identity password, these are what I'm gonna set my application pool to. The next one is the site name. This is what I'll set the site to. And coincidentally, I cheated. If I say it's the site name, I always paste on the end of the site path here. Whatever you make this site name will be on the end of the second variable. So it'll be, if the site name was Tom, it would be dwebsitesdevtom, right? So if you didn't pass a variable, that's the way it would be. But I'm gonna show you that we're actually setting it the way we want it in the tool, okay? Then the next one is a host header. Now, for the purposes of this demonstration, I purposefully went to my host file and set wingtip dev, wingtip QA, wingtip.com all to my local hosts so that I could show you that they actually work with a host header, just so that if there's any questions about them. Could have done it in a script, but I chose to just do it manually, purely because of time. All right. So this is basically the inputs to this script. Now, to the meat of what it's actually doing. Which, all right. So it starts right there with a line 154 with a set variable. So the very first thing I do is I create a log file, temporary log file directory, which the function you showed me today, sir, would be very helpful. I could use that instead of what I'm doing now, because I actually rewrote some of this scripting to actually create a temp file, and I did not know about that module. So thanks for showing me. You always learn something new every time. In any case, that's used throughout the process of logging as to where we're going to log our log files at. And then, if you recall, up here at the top, I told you there was I don't know if I told you or not, but there's a hash table. And the hash table has a name and then the directory where that name is. So what I do is I take the name and prepend it on the end, and I import the custom module that away. That's how I got over the strictness of the way that PowerShell brings modules in, where you have to have it the same directory name as your module. That's how I got over. And plus, at the time that I wrote this, the folks at Pulte weren't ready for anybody putting things in the PS module path. So that's the other reason I wrote it, so that I could just load it and then remove it. Okay, moving on, we get the date, and then we write it to the log file. Then instead of using web administration tools, I have some older code that I wrote that imports a DLL, the same web administration DLL, and I operate it almost the same way, but slightly different. That's what this is doing. It's getting me an object that holds the IIS server. And then I'm going to set some variables for some of the common things that I told you about that I'm going to do. Set it to .NET 4, set it to auto start, that it's not classic mode, which is that one that I showed you. I forget exactly which one it is. Then I'm setting the queue length to 1,000. And then I always, when you run this in a continuous integration type environment, you always have to write to logs all the time because you can't tell what's going on. So get in the habit, if you can, when you're writing your code, if you're planning on using it all the time, every day, all day, figure out a good way to come up with a good logging scheme for yourself that works for you. And this is just the way I chose to implement it. And I actually pass a switch, I think, called write to screen. So it'll write to the screen as well as write to the log with my write log function that I wrote. And then moving on here, this is where we actually create the pool right here. So we give it the manager that we got up here. We give it the pool name, which is passed in as one of the parameters. Then we have the app identity user, the app identity password, the manage runtime version. If it's set to auto start, if it's classic mode or not, what the queue length is, what our idle time is, and what our restart time is. Those are some of the common functions. And when I set up an app pool, that's what I pass in. And then moving on, we come down to new website. So here we're giving it a site name, the site path, and the host header. And we're telling it if it's there, just override it. We don't care. That's what the force switch means. Then moving on, then this is the function where it adds. I have a function inside my IIS library called add user to group. It will actually take the environment computer name or whatever name you pass it, add the app identity user to the IIS users group. Okay, all these are in modules. If you want any of this code, you're welcome to it. I'd love to be able to explain all of them to you, but I don't think we have enough time to do all that. So, but I wanted to at least show you that, yes, this 90% of this is all PowerShell code that I've stitched together. All right. Then we remove the default website. If it's there, we don't need it. I don't need to use it for anything, so we just take it out. And if this is where we actually create the directory for the where we're going to deliver the website. This is all before the files are dropped. I can't remember how I did it. This is made so that if you're deploying this before you drop the files, it'll create the directory. If it's not, if it's already there, it won't do anything. Okay? So then we add the NTFS permissions for the IIS user with that path and the permissions that you see right here. So it's giving list directory, read and execute, read attributes, read data, and read extended attributes, etc. And then applying it to the children. Okay? And then, I don't know about you, but I can't stand to clean up after myself as far as logs go. So I wrote this function called reset log. What it does is it looks to see if there are let me scroll up a little bit. In this case, it looks to see if there's over 5 logs, which is the log count, or if it's over a megabyte. If it's over a megabyte, it takes it and puts a .1 to the end of it and kicks off a new log file, and then it'll roll them until you get to 5 and then drops off 6. So what you end up with is this rolling log file pattern. So you go 1 through 5 and boom. 1 through 5, boom. That way you don't have to clean up after yourself. Okay? And then last but not least, just as a convention, I don't know about you, but I've done it to myself plenty of times. You write a script and you change directory to someplace, and you keep writing, and then you forget to change back to where you started. So I always like to use a push and a pop, which push actually takes the present directory wherever you start from, pushes it to the stack, and then at the end, if you want to go back to where you started, just pop it and it'll come right back. It's like doing a CD, so you don't have to remember it. You just push it on stack and then pop it back off. I will demonstrate for you since you asked. If it'll cooperate with me. Okay, she asked me what a push and a pop would do with a directory. Just very simply, I'll show you. So I'm just going to do a push D, which is an alias for push, alias push D. D. Push location. Okay? So now if I do cd / temp, I can tie it. I guess there's no temp on here. Okay, notice I'm in, if I do $pwd, I'm in the C drive, right? Now if I do pop D, ta-da, that's where I started. Yes. Like, so let's say that you start, in the case of what I was doing with the loading the custom modules, when I go into the custom module load, I change directory to where that is, do whatever I need to do in that path and import the variable, import the module, and then I pop to go back from wherever it was called from. So it makes it so that you can navigate around the file system and do whatever you need to do, and then get and return it back the way you found it. Real fast and easy thing.
When you put the modules, don't you specify the little path?
Yes. No, you don't, but yes, I don't remember how I did it. I would have to go look at the code. I can't remember if I changed directory to it or if I passed the full path. I think what I do is get item, if I remember correctly. Everybody familiar with get item? Where you type in, you type in something like this, get item, and you do C like this. Ah. Oh, man. I'll just go to where I know I got code. There we go. Finally got to what I was looking for. So now if I just enclose this in, treat this as an object and just type in dot full name, that'll give me the full path to that. And I can use that in my scripts. That's probably what I did. To answer your question, sir, that's probably what I did. I don't know if you can see this or not. That's probably what I did. This where this is the variable. And then I just use the full name property. Okay. Okay. Now, I don't know if you guys noticed, I'm actually using TFS Git for storing all my source code in. Here is the source code I showed you, and I've actually got it checked out to see TFS Git on my machine, and that's where I'm doing my check-in and check-outs from. So what I'd like to do next is I'll show you the rest of what's going on with what's called a release inside of TFS. So notice here, I've done a number of releases for this just to make sure I was ready to talk to you guys. So what I'm going to do is I'll click on this dev wingtip that you see here and edit this. And you'll see how I'm stitching these scripts together. Can everybody see that, or you need me to zoom in a little bit? Let me zoom in a little bit. All right. Let's see here. Okay, the very first thing that you see right here with this machine file copy, what this is doing is the way these tasks work in TFS is you give it the source location from where you're gonna pull items from. And what this is it's taking it from the working directory from the build server and deploying it to where we tell it to put it, which is D PowerShell scripts. Okay? Which this is where it will stage. It will actually deliver the files to during the release. So if we had more than one machine, what we would do is up here in the machines parameter, we would just put I think it's a semicolon separated list of machines that we'd copy to, other than this local host, and it would copy the scripts that we have checked out on the build machine out to the D PowerShell scripts on every machine recursively.
Is TFS able to import like a CSV or anything like that, or pick that up from any other location, or would you have to type it in here?
So the short answer is yes, with PowerShell code you could do that. So I'll show you some other stuff that we could do, which is you wouldn't even have to do some of these built-in things. I just did it because it was quick and fast. The very first one is about copying the scripts that we're going to use during execution. And then the next one is actually our business code that we're going to use for when we're doing our, you know, stand up our website. That's actually what matters to Mr. Business User in this particular case. So we're actually deploying that, and we actually have to, the other thing I'd like to mention is, notice this can be, you can use a variable here instead of what I have built in. I just did this for demonstration purposes. I have another one. I think I set it where it was just a variable that you set inside of TFS. But you can make it so that every username and password, if you want it to be, can be hidden, whatever you need to do, okay? I just wanted to prove to you that it was actually using our username and password. Then the script I just went through at length to show you. So What the? What happened, dude? There we go. Come on, Tom. Okay. If you recall earlier, I showed you that script that I went through at length. Here's the app identity, username, password. Here's the password for website. Here's the site name we're going to use, which is actually a variable from TFS. We actually set the variable in TFS, and we're using it from there. Here's the site path for where we're delivering to and our host header. And some of the other information that you saw is parameters into that script. Okay? The one in gray, I've actually, you can actually disable a task in here if you want to. I chose to use this other type to actually show you that you could actually, if you wanted to do a transform or something of that nature, actually on your build box, you could do it that way. Or you could use, I mean, there's a number of different tasks that you could add. This is just another task that Microsoft has that you can go get. It's called PowerShell++. And again, we're using a config transform, which I'll show you what that looks like. I don't remember did I show you guys this script or not? Okay. So this config transform takes a source file, which is our web config, okay? It takes a transform file, which if you recall, that was that transform that I showed you in Visual Studio, right? There's a web.environment.config. It takes that, and then the DST is shorthand for destination. So we pass in the starting file, the transform, and then what we want the file to be. In most cases, what we normally do at Pulte is we put the name of the web config for the app, then the transform, and then overwrite the one that we started with. So you don't have extra files if you don't need them. Okay? Any questions? Then if we go in here, there's a function inside of here, and what those variables you actually pass actually call this function. So I didn't actually write this code. We absconded it from somebody else. But I can explain to you how the rest of it works. So during the deployment process, we're actually going to deliver this transform DLL. And because PowerShell is great at dealing with .NET objects, what we're actually doing here is pulling this .NET DLL in and then calling methods inside of that .NET DLL once we cast the, once we make an object that is actually that .NET thing, for lack of a better term, which in this case just happens to be this variable called doc. So there's a method called preserve white space. We want to preserve it. So it's a setting. It's actually a property that you set on the object to tell it, okay, yes, I want to keep the white space the way it is. Leave it alone. So up here, as I told you before, I try to whenever I'm writing scripts, and especially when I'm going to use them over and over and over again in continuous integration, try to write to a log somewhere. In this particular case, we're writing to output, hoping that TFS will actually show that to us. Hopefully. If not, we'll have to write a custom module. Then we're going to transform our object. So we're going to create a new TRN object, which is actually this transform document. So we're going to do a new object and cast it to this type. So this type right here will actually be this right here. So in other words, what that means is we're creating a new object, and the instantiation of that object with the past values that are that transform object will be contained in that dollar train. Okay? If you don't get it, I can show you in a little bit. Because I always have a hard time with this stuff too, so don't feel alone. Okay, then we're going to apply we're going to apply the transform. So we're taking this transform, and there's a method called apply, and we're going to apply it to this document. Okay? If that works, then we're going to save it to the destination file name. Okay? If not, we're going to throw. We're going to say, hey, sorry, didn't work. File's wrong, something's wrong. But very simply, that's what it is. Okay? Okay, which is this particular script that you see here. This is actually that transform script. In this particular case, we are taking, the websites, and then that dollar sites is actually a variable inside a TFS that defines what our site name is, and it's web corresponding web config. And then what you see up here at the top of the web.dev.config is actually the transform file. And then the destination we're saving to is actually the same location as the source that you see here. Okay? Okay, then we have some housekeeping things that we need to do. Whenever we set up a site and put it in place, we need to start the site and start the pool. And that's what these two functions do. So the next one, there's actually, do you guys want me to show those scripts, or you want me to show the whole thing work? Show the scripts, okay. So there, another script that I have is IIS actions. And what this IIS actions does is it either starts, stops a site, a pool, or IIS. Okay? Or restarts. Depending on what you're looking for. My compatriot in crime at Pulte wrote this one. So, in any case, this is the IIS action script. So, the parameters are, we have a validate set on start, stop, or recycle. So what that means is, when you call this script, you either have to specify start, stop, or recycle. That's all you get, the three options. The next one is action, and then it has three items in its validate set, which is site, pool, and IIS. So you either you have to pass, since they're both mandatory, you have to pass either an action of start, stop, or recycle, and you have to pass either type of site, pool, or IIS, okay? That's what those mean. And the next one is servers. So this is an array. You could send it an array of servers if you wish. I took some code out so that it would work locally. A lot of this had invoke commands that would actually run the start and stop on remote systems. Right now, because I only need it to work locally, I just made it to make work locally. And then, of course, the names is the name of the thing that we're going to do the action on. Okay? So, all right, then moving on, down here where the actual script starts, which is on line 105. We're going to import the web administration module because we'll need that to be able to do some of the activities we're going to do. And then we're going to check to see if it's if we don't get a value pass for servers, then we'll assume it's the local host, which is what this means. Okay? And then we're going to test the actions. If it's recycled, then we're going to do a special function. If it's not, then we're going to drop into this start stop sites, which the start stop sites takes an action, the servers and names, and it has a loop for the servers and a loop for the names, and then it will perform the action of, if it's site, it'll stop the website. If it's site, and it stopped, if the action is stop and the type is site, then it will go to stop website right here for the particular name that you're on. And many of these are exactly the same way. Okay? Any questions? Now, if If I was a good DevOps guy in this demo that I would have done for you, I would have had two other scripts in here that were before I actually ran the drop of the files. Anybody know what that might be? Okay, I can tell you. What you want to do is you always want to make sure you get the right files, because it never fails. A developer will check something in, they'll delete something, they'll add something, stuff like that. More often than not, it's a delete that's a problem. So generally speaking, what we do when we do our deployments is the very first thing we'll do is stop the website, stop the app pool, and then delete all the files. And then we do a full delivery of all the files again. That's one thing I didn't do in this demo, but it's something that you should do. And it is what we do operationally at Pulte every day. Because it'll bite you if you don't. All right, so then again, as you can see, I'm just calling the same script twice. Since we've delivered the actual files to the file system in this D PowerShell scripts, we know our script's going to be there. So we just call it from there. Okay? All right, and then the very last script that I wanted to show you is this script here. Let me see if I can reposition this a little bit. Oh, come on, TFS. Okay, so this particular PowerShell plus utility has a couple different ways you can run it. You can run it with an inline script, which is what I'm demonstrating here, or you can do it with a script that works with the build server, and you tell it where it is when it actually constructs the build, it delivers the files, it'll put it in these long numbered files that only it understands, and thankfully there's variables to understand where that is if you ever need them. In any case, that's what this script will allow you to do, is an inline script. So what I did is I wrote a very simple and quick and dirty invoke web request script. So what I'll do is I'll show you this really quickly, what this does. So what this does is it very simply uses invoke web request, uses basic parsing, and then hits this website, wingtipdev.com, and one of the returned objects from wingtip from that call is called raw content that you see here. And then we just do a search and see if it matches Wingtip Toys Dev, and it'll give us a true or false. So that tells us whether or not the site's actually operational. Very, very simple. Extremely simple.
So do you know if TFS with the Git integration exposes like the branch and build number, and then could you tag like your deployment with that so you can verify this is the build I intended to deploy?
Yes, so what you could, so as part of the build, so the question is with TFS labeling, branching, all that kind of business, could you actually look at your delivered content to see if the number matches what you actually built? Yes, I think so. I haven't done it myself, but I know that when you actually compile and use the built-in tools that come with Visual Studio, you can add a version scheme to your binaries that are produced. It'll actually put a date and timestamp, or it'll put a version number, however you decide you want to do it. And then what you could do is you could use PowerShell to actually get the item, and then you look at the properties that are inside that Git item that you did for the DLL, and you could find out what version you actually deployed. Or there are a bunch of web APIs that are available and accessible that you could actually query the TFS API at the very end and say, okay, give me the build number. You can write the file. You could write it right to a text file, or, you know, whatever you need to write it to. Like if you have to go write it to an inventory management system that's keeping track of what your applications are, what their assets, all that kind of jazz, you could do it. The key, though, is try to keep things as simple as possible so you have less stuff to fix, right? Okay, this all makes sense. Okay, so you guys ready for me to see if it breaks? Okay. So do you want me to play like a developer or just show you the first time? that we can actually do a build and it'll actually do a release. So I'm, let's say I'm a QA person, I'm ready for code to go to my QA environment and everything else. Or let's say I have a process that dictates that it goes to QA and then approval. I could show you where those approvals are, but we'll just assume for sake of brevity that we're just going to deploy to QA, but in actuality what I built will deploy to everything. So you, in any case, a QA person could come in here, they just hit Q build, and then specify any variables or extra things that you want to have happen when you do the build, then hit OK. Okay, so it's building the source code. So it's checking the code out of TFS. That's where it's actually, it's waiting for it to be worked on and queued. And notice that everything that you see here is pretty much PowerShell. PowerShell window, PowerShell looking window. So it's getting, it's doing a get out of get. I'll let you guys watch the paint dry. You could do this same type of thing with XAML builds, which is the old pain in the neck build system that they had, which you either love or you hate XAML. I don't know if you guys use XAML quite a bit.
Can I just say, if you're putting something new together, that's not what you
want to
go
with. I concur. I concur. Am I missing anything? Since you probably do a lot of the same thing I do.
We don't really do as much as you do from an automation standpoint.
Okay.
We haven't actually used the new stuff for building
that. Man, it took me 4 months from the release of release 2 to get it actually implemented in production so we could start using this. And my compatriot in crime is passing me up. In terms of getting things implemented, so. Okay, so the build succeeded. Now, since the build succeeded, what we should see is on the release side of the house, it should be automatically deploying to our environments. So if you'll notice here, if we actually had approval workflow in place, there would actually be a little hourglass timer, hourglass thingy, for lack of a better term, that would indicate there's an approval needed. And you can set that to whomever you want it to be. It follows the same kind of conventions that you would use for 80 Active Directory, right? You can put Active Directory groups, that kind of thing in it. So let me go ahead and go to this release. And so the deployment to dev actually finished. And here's our, you can see the status of every one of those scripts that we ran that I demoed for you just a couple minutes ago. While that's executing, I want to show to you, this is what we looked like before we started this session. I had no pool, no sites here, okay, nothing. So now I'm going to refresh this. We should see 3 sites here. Ta-da, we got a dev, QA, and a prod. Okay, let's see how they're bound. I'm just going to go over to the app pools so we'll get a good refresh. So there's our app pools. Notice the identity set. If I chose to, I could have picked another identity for QA and whatnot, but hopefully you guys understand that it will actually set those up based on whatever. So long as they're valid, it'll set it to the user that you want. And I actually use this with a domain account at Pulte, so. And there in turn is our sites with their corresponding host headers. You see wingtip dev, wingtip.com, and wingtip QA. Yeah, so what, Tom? Did that actually work? I don't know, let's go see. So here's wingtip dev. Notice that you'll see right up here our transform went from local to dev, which is what I wanted to make sure that you guys understood. We're actually using a different connection, which I'll show you in just a moment. Okay? Notice up there in the title bar up there, it says wingtip QA. Okay, so we know our transforms worked. We know we're on the QA environment. And then let's look at the final. And remember, if you recall, I put in just quotes with a single space in it, and it changed it to wingtip toys production. Okay? So now, if we look at the actual file system, and we go to D websites, you'll notice we have a dev, QA, and a prod. And if we look at our web config, you'll notice wingtip toys MDF right there, which is where the file it's actually using for SQL Express. And in addition to that, you have the environment value of dev, okay, which is where IIS is pointing, which if you look here, basic settings, you'll notice we're pointed to DDEV. See that? And commensurately, the production side. Wow, it only took me an hour? Was it only an hour? Awesome. I think that's what I have in Singapore, I think. I don't remember. Let's see, basic settings. And again, there we're going QA.
Is
there
going to be a trend soon?
Got me.
Laden.
Okay. I know, I mean, there's a lot of stuff that's in here as far as building a site, setting it all up. I'd be happy to go, if you guys have any questions at all, please ask me. I'd be happy to show you whatever it is you want to see. Yes, sir, please. I have, actually on my GitHub site, I wrote some utilities that will actually go out to a site that has a bunch of certificates on it and pull the certificates down into, not serve files, I forget the extension. It'll pull them down from a site and then you could actually reconsume those and deploy them to something else. So yes, they do have to be there and it has to be valid for the zone that you're going to use it in. That makes sense? Oh, you want me to repeat the question? The question was, when you're dealing with HTTPS, do you have to have the certificate there? The answer is yes. And do I have scripts that will actually copy the, do I have something or do I know of something that will do that? Yes, I do. I have some stuff that I put together in GitHub that I'd be happy to share them with you. And if you find a bug in them, please tell me or fix it. I challenge you to fix it. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
What were some of the biggest, you said it took about 4 months to get it up and running. What were some of the biggest hiccups, problems?
So the question was, if I understand you correctly, is why did it take so long to set up TFS at the company I'm at? Is that correct?
I didn't say it like that.
No, but that's basically what it boiled down to, right? So the company I work at is very heavily in .NET. Everywhere from 2008 all the way up through 2013. What took the longest was actually setting up a test TFS machine, getting the export from production, pulling the export into my dev environment, and then running through and making sure that my XAML scripts worked, along with my compatriot in crime, he and I worked it together, making sure that the XAML stuff worked, making sure that the release management that we were using previously, which plugged into TFS 2013, the older one, which I'm not a big fan of. I'm so glad we were going to almost pure PowerShell. That one was sorta, kinda, somewhat PowerShell, sorta. But this one's much easier, it's much more, this one's much, very similar to Octopus. Have you ever heard of Octopus? So that's what took the most time, was getting a dev environment set up and making sure that we went through and tested everything. To answer your question, that's why it took three, 4 months. Let me get a drink. Anybody else? Go ahead. Yes, sir.
I've never seen the TMS before, but is that supposed to be an equivalent to like Chef or some of the other automation services that are coming out on the forefront of the industry?
The short answer is I have never really worked a whole lot with Chef or Puppet. My distinct opinion and belief is that, yes, they're trying to compete with those products with this. Because there are so many things you can do with it. They really opened up. Microsoft, if you guys remember, a long time ago, they were a very closed source. They didn't want anybody messing with their stuff. Well, now they kind of like, they did a 180. It's just kind of the other way around. They open source PowerShell, they open sourced, I mean, a lot of this stuff that you see tasks and whatnot in here, you can go write your own task and then publish it, and whoever wants to use it could use it. Cool stuff.
DSC would be more equivalent to PowerShell, this would be more like a GUI for PowerShell. Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. You can also deploy DSC with this as well, by the way. I have not done it yet. I want to, but my problem is much of what I see DSC being is more of, there's two camps in the company I belong to, which is, there's the camp of the infrastructure guys, and we stand up the infrastructure and do all this other kind of stuff. And then there's the camp of, I support application guys, so it's a little bit more difficult for me to go into the DSC space because it spans the whole thing. So that's probably the biggest reason I haven't stepped into it yet, because I'm closer to the developers and actually setting up everything from helping them with their builds to make sure that it builds and deploys their web services as well as their service code. Like if they write a Windows service, then we make sure that the same kind of behavior where you'd have a transform file will transform the config properties for a service as well. So I don't know if I answered your question. Did I answer your question? Anybody else? Yes, sir.
What type of resources did you use to learn the TFS nuances and such? In the Microsoft Intel Cache or just thinking around?
The question was, is how did I learn TFS? It's a long-winded answer, but in short, there's some really good MVAs that you can go get that are free, as I recall. And there's also some good stuff if you're on Pluralsight. Have you ever been on Pluralsight? Go look at Pluralsight. It'll show you that stuff. the other part of it is I've been in a DevOps-type capacity for at least the last 10 or 15 years. So I've used TFS. I've used older versions of TFS. And I was largely familiar with just the deploy and provision, the other side, which is less on the build and construction side as opposed to the release side. That's where I primarily was in the last 10 years. I've just of late gotten to where I'm beginning to understand what a solution file is and what it actually does. So a solution file that you saw in there that a developer actually uses to build their code is no more than a fancy config file. It's a huge config file. So did I answer your question? Okay. Anybody else? Go ahead, sir. Please go ahead. Sure. Okay.
Go back. It was one of the other tabs that you were on, maybe code or work.
Sorry about that. My mouse is going nutty on me. Okay, here's the code tab. Okay. Not here, right? Oh, here? Right here? Okay, was it? Oh, yeah, so in the release.
Okay, yeah. Can you kind of walk, like, let's say you wanted to create one of these from scratch.
Okay.
Can you kind of
Sure. So the most important thing first is figure out what it is you need to do. Write some PowerShell to get that done first. Make sure it works before you even plug it in here. Number one. And you can do it on your own box, do it on a dev box, do it wherever you got to do it. That's number one. Number two is then you need to think about what your environment's going to look like and what you're going to do as far as deployments. And so what you do here is you would add a task. So here's all the different tasks that you can do. You can add in other tasks. So we can do Android and all kinds of different things. You figure out which task it is you want to use, and when you add that task, if there's help for it, like if we were to add, let's say we're just to add this one, Start Stop Azure Resource Groups. Down here at this, the bottom of the task, I don't know if you could see it or not, there's a more, I'm sorry about the, can't help this, so. This will actually take you to where it is that it describes what this task does. Okay? On Microsoft site or GitHub or wherever it is. So this will show you what this task does. Okay? And I'll actually give you the code for it. It's more than likely just a PowerShell script. So the short answer to a very long-winded demonstrate the whole thing is if you get it working the way you want it to work on your desktop in the scripts that you want, right, then you can plug those scripts in individually as actions to either run locally, run remotely, or whatever your requirements are. But remember, if you run them locally, they run on the build server, which is the thing that's actually doing the work. It's sending out the tasking, all that kind of stuff. Because the way it's constructed in such that TFS has these things called agents in a pool that are behind the scenes that actually receive the work and then do whatever needs to be done, whether it's building it or deploying the code. And so some of these, I'm cheating, I'm actually running it locally when most of them should be run remotely. So it's doing it over remoting, if you're familiar with PowerShell remoting. So the other thing that you would need to make sure, some of your setup stuff that you would have to make sure of, is make sure that if you can do it, put a demand policy in place for everything that's 2012 and below that you want to deploy to, have remoting turned on for whether it's HTTPS or HTTP, whichever one you want to use. We chose to take the simple route, use HTTP. And that really depends on your attack surface, right, as to what you would do. Yes. Yes, you can tell it right down here at the bottom. Do you see? I don't know if you can see this switch here or not. Let me see if I can move it up a little bit. Oh, goodness gracious. Can you see that right there? You can tell it that it's enabled or continue on error or always run. So if it fails, it will stop the process flow. But if you set it to continue on error, it'll just error and keep going. So long and short of it is I made my scripts first and got something that worked. I actually got this that script that I showed you that was pretty lengthy, which is this setup wingtip. I got this to work so that I could actually go to my PowerShell prompt, type in what I wanted, and it would build the site right from that script. That's what I chose to do. There are other plugins that you can get from Microsoft that actually do the same thing. Let's see, there's an IIS one in here. Let me see if I can find it. Yeah, here's a web app deployment that we can use with WinRM. Sorry? Yes, that's so the question was, is it using WinRM to talk to the remote servers? The answer is yes, which is PowerShell remoting. So I could have used this, but I already had a bunch of stuff done, and I wanted it a particular way, and I know it works, so I chose to use what I wrote already. So I guess the short answer is there's a lot of different ways to do it. You got to figure out the best way that works for you and that you have confidence in. There's no smoking gun.
Can we look at the task again? Is it an SSCM task in there?
Yeah, you could almost rebuild this whole thing using like a task sequence.
Yeah.
Obviously, wouldn't have the Git integration, but.
What are you looking for again, sir?
SSCM.
SSCM. Yes, I believe it runs with SCCM, I think. Yeah, you could actually do NuGet installs, NuGet Packager, Publisher. I just ran a few of these. There's so much more it can do. Run a shell script. Execute a bash script if you needed to. Visual Studio test. There's a whole bunch of them. I did. Yeah, I'm actually going to do that next. I'm actually planning on standing up a PowerShell inside of Mac and do my deployments because I actually have to build some iOS apps. I'm hoping to actually PowerShell the whole thing. That's one of my aspirational goals is to do that, but we'll see how that works out. Are there?
Yeah. And there's some stuff, I think, from Bill earlier this year. There was one of the guys that's like a program manager or something for Visual Studio, maybe online or just Visual Studio, right? The build system, the team system. And he did some of the videos as well. So, you know, if you wanted to look on Channel 9, look at the events, and look at build, and look for, you know, DevOps, things like that as the tags, and you'll find some.
I think it's awesome. I mean, it's so much better than the old Visual Studio. So much better.
Can you repeat Channel
9? Yes. For those of you that might be listening up there, out in the world, there are quite a few videos that are on Channel 9 that you could go look and search for how to use Visual Studio and how to use TFS on-prem and Visual Studio online, which is the equivalent of this, but in online capacity.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Well, I hope this worked. Took me a little while to get here. I'm sorry I had to gloss over so much of the scripting I have, but hopefully you got the idea that yes, it actually does work. It works every time. What I'm planning on doing for every demo that I do this with is I wrote a special release called Cleanup, and I actually have to add a little bit of extra PowerShell to it because I made a mistake and forgot to import the web administration module. So if you're all familiar with the web administration module that comes with IIS, it creates a PowerShell provider. Does everybody know what a PowerShell provider is? Okay, if you don't, I'll show you. All right, so I have this little script that I wrote called Cleanup. And what it's going to do is it's going to go out, change directory to IIS once we've imported the web administration module. So the fact that I'm changing to IIS colon means that I'm using a provider, PowerShell provider. And then I'm going to go remove the site called QA, prod, and dev, and then remove the app pools of the same thing, and then remove the directory structure. So if we look here, we'll notice we still have items there. Oh, and just to prove to you that I actually set the permissions on the folder. Here's the IIS users, read, list folder contents. For those of you that care, it actually does it in the script. So I'll just run this real quick. I must have made a mistake.
Were you going to replace on the recurse? So you have two recurse.
Oops. I knew that was there somewhere. I just couldn't figure out where it was. Thank you. I'll run this again. Too early to say ta-da. I must have missed the one on dev. Yeah, you're right. Good call. Good call. You know, that's the one thing that PowerShell doesn't have that I wish you could find is handle.exe in pure PowerShell. Which there's a guy by the name of, he wrote some of the plugins for Visual Studio. His name escapes me at the moment. He wrote handle.ps1, but he never finished it. I've been watching his GitHub repository waiting for him to finish it. So, which could help solve that particular problem. We got a file handle open. Yeah, there we go. Ta-da! Now I can say ta-da. So again, if we look here, ta-da! Okay, so that it's cleaned it up now ready for my next demo. What I just did delete my D PowerShell directory. I'll have to add that next. Okay. I hope this kind of gave you a teaser and also something to explore if you want to. As always, if I can be of any help somehow, please hit me up. I have some of my code that I've constructed for some of this out on GitHub. So, or if you want it, I'll post it. I mean, there's nothing proprietary in it. And I make mistakes like everybody else, so I'm sure it's got a bug in it somewhere. Somewhere. Just haven't found it yet. Thanks.
Thank you.
The other thing I would encourage you to do is, the main reason I set this up is because I'm a PowerShell nut, and I love PowerShell. And number two, I like to see who else is a nut like me. So please make sure you mingle with others. So if you could trade scripts or trade ideas, that's the reason I stood this back up again. And also selfishly, I just moved to the area last year, but that wasn't the main reason. I also met some good people too. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Huh?